kind of feel like I need to go. I think that's what they call tickling the keys. What a great day. Once again, the sun is shining through. It is a wonderful day to come and worship the Lord. Of course, we're always happy to see one another. It's a great day to see each other, but also happy to see those of you who may be visiting with us today. We're thrilled that you're here. Hope that you have time afterwards. Sorry, something in my eye. Yeah, now you all look much better. Hope that you have time, if you're visiting with us, to join us. Our pattern here after worship is we tend to make our way down the stairs and back into what we call the fellowship hall, and we enjoy cookies and coffee there. However, today we are disrupting our pattern. Remember last week I joked that you should sit on opposite sides? We're going to start by doing that first. No, I'm just kidding. The pattern is going to be disrupted this morning in this way. Much work has taken place over the summer. The deacons have been very active and engaging others to do great things. And so downstairs, in preparation for the school year this year, Sunday school and all, there is new carpeting. There's a question about what we're going to call the red carpet room, since it's no longer red carpet. And then there's also been painting done. So it's beautiful downstairs. And we think you should take a moment to see it, to appreciate it, to give a deacon a nice pat on the back, to appreciate all the work that's been done, as well as to appreciate those of our Nikki and Gracie who do all that work of coordinating all of our leadership and training our kids. They had to move everything. And now it's all been put back, or mostly put back, but we'd like you to take a tour after worship downstairs and just take a quick look around to see how things have changed, if you are able. Otherwise, you can make a bypass and go straight to the coffee and cookies. The rest of you go downstairs, check it out, come back upstairs, and get your coffee and cookies as a reward. So that's our pattern this morning. And if you're new here, that's what's happening, and that's why everyone around you also looks confused this morning. All right? Now, I want to also say, after that announcement, that we are busy in our weeks. Right now, there's harvesting going on. There's activity going on M40 with all the construction, and I understand there'll be paving on Monday or working towards that. It's a disruptive time. We have a lot on our mind. But we've come here to worship God, to give God all glory and all praise. We've come here to think less about ourselves and more about God. And the psalmist in Psalm 115 was working on that shift away from ourselves to shifting and thinking about God. And the psalmist wrote this: "Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory." I want you to hear that again. Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory for the sake of your steadfast love and faithfulness. We've come to give glory to God for his steadfast love and faithfulness, his grace and mercy to us through Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins that we have, and the new life that we can live now in him. So for that reason, we've come to give glory and praise to God and just be filled by his presence. Let us praise God.
To worship, come. as you are before your God come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee shall bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. The time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Jesus set me free. Look at the wounds that give me life, grace flowing from his side, no greater sacrifice. What he's done, all the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done. Sing for the freedom he has won. Even death is dead and done. Even life has overcome. Speak, say the name above all names, over every broken place. He is risen from the grave. What he's done, oh, what he's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done. Now on a throne of majesty, the Father's will complete. He reigns in victory. Sing alleluia to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring. What he's done, oh, what he's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done. What he's done, oh, what he's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My future is forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done. I praise God for what he's done. Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run. The fountain I drink from, oh, he is my song. let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, He is my song. You are good, good, oh. You are good, good, oh. Let the King of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, He is my song. Let the King of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, He is my song. You are good, good, oh. You are good, good, oh. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down.
May God indeed be praised. We have gathered together in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. And now let us greet one another with the peace that comes from knowing Jesus. Greet your neighbor, won't you? When we have baptisms, particularly baptisms of infants, we make promises as a whole congregation. Not only does the family that is up here make a promise to raise the child in the faith, but we too make a promise that that family won't walk alone, but that we will join with that family to help raise the child in the faith. There are many ways we do that. A good smile, a caring, watching over, being that additional larger family during fellowship times when little kids are running around and need just an extra eye to watch and care. There are many ways we do this, but one of the specific ways today that we are lifting up is the method of teaching. We've come to that time of year when we're going to begin our educational time after worship. It'll start 2 weeks from now, but we have volunteers who have stepped forward and say, yes, I think this is my time to serve, whether it is again or for the first time, to serve and help our children grow in the faith. And anyone who has taught knows that when you teach, you're probably the one who learns the most. Teaching is such a gift. It's not just a gift that comes from within, but it's a gift to the person who does such. So this morning, we want to take a moment and set aside those who've stepped forward and said they are willing to teach this year. Some are doing it for the full course. Some are doing it as substitutes. Some are doing it in tandem. But for whoever and however, we want to give God the glory for their work, and we want to undergird them in prayer and support. So I'd like to ask at this moment, you're not going to have to come up here, but if you have agreed to teach, whether it's teaching a class or substituting, or even those who are giving some prayer support, I'd like you to just stand at this time so that we can pray as a congregation for you. Would you please do that? I know, don't be first, right? We just give God the glory. Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to you be all glory. That's how we started worship. Let's take a moment to pray. Oh Lord, we just thank you. We thank you that your Spirit has worked in the hearts of these individuals to bring them to this time to help our children to grow in their understanding of who you are and how much you love them. We pray that you would bless each of these who stand at this moment, that they might have the strength and the wisdom, the courage to do the work that you set before them. We also pray that you would undergird them, Lord, with your support, just as you have promised to be with us, to lift us up on wings like eagles when we are tired and weary. Oh, Lord, we pray for your strength and guidance and wisdom. And we also pray, oh, Lord, that you would put a special blessing upon these who have stood, that they may truly learn themselves, that they may grow and be blessed by this time. We pray all this, Jesus, in your precious name. Amen. Go ahead, you may be seated. Thank you. Now, one additional item. It turns out we have one more spot to be filled. The spot is for our second and third graders. And what I'd like you to do is consider whether God is calling you to be their teacher. Or maybe you have kind of what we'll call a partial call, where you're feeling like a nudge, but really it can't be the whole thing. Maybe you're being called to partner up with someone and share the responsibility where one does one week and another does another week. Or maybe you're going to be part of a larger group, but whatever that is, listen to the Spirit's leading, for it is a time for you to grow as well. And you can talk to Nikki or Gracie about the possibilities. And by the way, talking to them doesn't commit you. It's a conversation. But please consider. All right. A reminder that you've been invited to go downstairs following worship, also to see the educational space, to see the new carpet, to see the new painting, and also to see this reorganization that's taking place, though not all of it's put in place. It's one of those classic moments where we get excited about fixing a room and call people to see it, and someone else says, wait a minute, I haven't put everything away yet. Just come and enjoy. And then another reminder for us this morning. And that reminder is that we have been doing nominations for consistory. That time has come and that opportunity has been before us. The ballots have been given to you. So please remember to prayerfully consider who God might be leading forward to be a deacon or an elder, to pray over that and to submit those nominations. And we will be blessed by that. Let's take time now to pray. Oh Lord, you know us full well. You know who we are. You know our every thought, our every deed. Such knowledge is too wonderful for us. And it's also extremely frightening. It's frightening to think that someone can lift back the curtain and know everything about us. We immediately find ourselves falling to our knees emotionally and in every other way and begging forgiveness for all that we truly are, O Lord. And yet as we do so, we know that we meet your mercy, your grace. Where we should rightly receive your judgment, we find instead your incredible love for us. That you're willing to wash over all of our sins, to wash us clean through your Son, Jesus Christ. Indeed, your love was for so great for us that you sent him to die in our place, to take our place instead, O Lord. He came to show your great love. Such knowledge is absolutely overwhelming. To recognize that we no longer walk in our strength, in our abilities, in who we might claim to be. Oh Lord, we spend decades trying to form and create some kind of image that other people perceive us to be, and yet none of that means anything compared to your grace. Help us, O Lord, to once again embrace that it's not what we do, it's not who we are, but rather, O Lord, it is who you are and what you have done in giving us your Son, Jesus Christ, that we now walk because he has given us life before you and the promise of new life with you forever. We praise you, Almighty God, for this incredible gift, the gift that we are once again reminded of as we come in to worship you, to recognize all that you've done. Help us, O Lord. Help us to be reshaped and reformed in an understanding that grasps just what you have done. Help us to live out of that understanding. Help us to live forward in a way that blesses others, not because we should, but because we're eager to share what we have received. Help us, Almighty God, to show love because we've received love. Help us to show forgiveness because we've received forgiveness. Help us to exercise grace when our first impulse would be to exercise judgment. Help us, O Lord, to see your mercy once again and to extend that mercy to others. Almighty God, may in doing such things, may lives be changed. May others come to know you, knowing that we aren't the reason that they come to know you, but that we are conveying the grace that truly draws others to you. Help us reflect your love, O Lord, not only here with one another. Surely that can be a practice space and a laboratory for how we begin to try and change who we are and follow more and more in your footsteps. This indeed can be a place of practice, O Lord. But help us to move beyond this place, to move into our friendships and our families, to move into our workplace and the places we encounter others, and help us to take what we've learned and what we've become and extend that to others. In short, O Lord, help us to remember that our calling is not to keep this blessing for ourselves, but to share and be this blessing for others. O Lord, as we do this, we go forward as your ambassadors, as the one you've sent us to be. But Lord, we go forward also with our concerns. We go forward with our joys as well as our concerns for those amongst us who are sick or not well, those of us who are dealing with chronic health issues that just don't seem to go away or that we know won't go away, and yet we wonder, is today a day where we're further diminished or is there a chance we might get a little bit better? In each case, O Lord, we pray for your patience, for your ever-present healing touch, that you would sustain us, that every breath that we take may be a breath for you and not for ourselves. We pray for those who've undergone surgery, for the healing that is taking place even now, a knitting together that you are doing. We pray that that may be fully accomplished, that once again we may be whole. And we pray for those amongst us, O Lord, who are broken, not externally, but really internally, in our very spirit. Those of us who are just simply down, discouraged, or even depressed. Those of us who see fall not as a glorious arrangement of colors, but a hallmark of the depressing winter months that are to come. Oh Lord, we pray for your healing touch there as well, that you would once again make us whole and to help us to live forward in courage without fear. All this, Lord, we lay before you, trusting our prayers are more than thoughts thrown into the air, but that you hear them and that they fall before the very throne of grace, because your Son has taught us to pray and has purposely taught us to pray in this way, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, if you're new this week, or if for some reason you've been away the last 2 weeks, we have been on a three-week journey, and this being the third week, of looking at the 12th chapter of Paul's letter to the church in Rome. We've been looking each week at one verse. So week one was verse one, week two, verse two. You get the idea. Today we're looking at the third verse and maybe a little more. But what we've been doing is we've been seeing how Paul is calling us to live, how we are to live now that we've heard the good news of Jesus Christ. So why don't we take a moment to pray that God would open his word to us, that we might hear this third verse. Oh Lord, may you bless us. May your word make sense to us. And where it doesn't make sense, may you bring understanding through your Spirit, that we might grow, that we might learn, and that we might be a blessing for others. In Jesus' name, amen. Here we are in Romans chapter 12, verse 3. Paul writes, "For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned." I was at a cross-country meet yesterday, and I have to tell you, I have come to love cross-country meets. I didn't know of them before. I mean, I knew of them, but I'd never been to one before. And if you've not been to a cross-country meet, allow me to share with you what I've learned. I really like sports, and I like competition. I like seeing the struggle and the challenge and people overcoming. That is fun for me. I like seeing all of us trying to be more than we are, and that is all epitomized at a cross-country meet, but in a fantastic way. At a cross-country meet, there is not this cheering that goes on, cheering against one another, but rather everyone that is there, both the opposing team or teams, as well as your team, the fans, everyone cheers for everyone. It is absolutely fascinating. You'll see people cheering on a runner that has nothing to do with who they are. They may have even caught what that runner's name is because another family friend or so forth and says, "Come on, let's go, Sarah." And they might start using that name. "Sarah, come on, you got it. Just conquer that hill. You got it." Everybody is cheering. Everybody is encouraging. Why do I share this with you? Because in a cross-country meet, there's also a lot of chaos. It's really hard to know just where the race will run. Oh, sometimes there's spray-painted lines on the ground, but there's nothing that keeps you from running near that line or walking over it. Matter of fact, a lot of people do. And so the race can go in all different ways, and nobody seems to really know where, except for that there's a rule, and the rule is don't interfere with the runners. That seems to be like the only rule. Don't get in the way of a runner. There's nothing that blocks you. It's like if you were watching a basketball game, you could freely walk on the court at any time. You just can't get in the way of the players. It's the same thing with these cross-country meets. I say this to you because the other day at this meet, a woman, not knowing what she was doing, just walking normally, was walking across the path. But she wasn't aware of it because there was kind of an amoeba of people. And the people had started to spread out because they knew something was happening, but she was unaware. And so someone finally yelled out because she wasn't moving, "Runners!" Now, if you heard someone yell "runners," anywhere along the line in life, you wouldn't think much of it. You might look. But as people kept yelling, runners, this woman suddenly had that idea that, oh no, where am I? Am I in the way? And the look of sudden frozen, as well as like, and looking down and seeing that the path, and then looking and trying, it's like suddenly finding yourself on the railroad tracks and you didn't know you were on them. And the scramble she had to get out of the way. And it was all because the context of cross country, if someone yells runners, just like if I were suddenly to say, heads up, there's a chance you might look up. With runners, you suddenly look. Where am I? Am I in the way? Paul is writing in a manner, in a context, that we have to keep in mind the very basics of what he's writing. Otherwise, we might get lost in the particular. We might forget where we are. And this is the very basics of Paul's context. He is continually in this letter talking about God's grace and the reaction to God's grace. God's grace and his reaction to God's grace and our reaction to God's grace. That's where Paul is. If sometimes we lose the thread of his thought, we can read the words just fine. We can kind of make sense of them, but we're not really sure what to do with them. We need to go back to the basic concept, just like when someone says runners, suddenly I need to look, where am I? Am I in the way? In this case, we need to look back and say, where is Paul? Because he's always talking about grace. And he's always talking about his response and our response to God's grace. That's where Paul always is. So we don't want to lose ourselves in what he writes and forget why he's writing what he's writing. I'll give you an example of how that works in the previous 2 weeks, the previous two verses. His first week that we read the words of, I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God. In other words, by the grace of God. That was where his appeal was coming from. That's where he was working from. He had built 11 chapters, particularly the three chapters before, all about God's grace. And he was taking that and he's saying, now looking at God's grace, I now appeal to you to do this. This is God's grace. Here's where response is going. And his call to us was to be a living sacrifice in that first week. To live as if we're giving ourselves fully to God. Last week he started to define a little bit about what does it look like to be a living sacrifice. I mean, none of us just want to be draped on an altar, still alive, wondering what we're supposed to do. What are we supposed to actively be doing? What does that look like? And again, we're in talking as a response to the grace. The response is, how do we live differently? What does that look like? Paul says last week, he says, look, I want you to no longer be conformed by the way the world forms us, but to be transformed. I want you to be changed. I want you to be changed by the grace of God. And that change is going to come through a renewing of your mind, a renewing of the way you think. A renewing of the way you see the world. I want you to see the world, Paul says, as God sees it. I want you to look at things the way God wills things to be. We say that in the Lord's Prayer. Your will be done, right? It's seeing things as God's will. That was week one and week two. Here we are in week three, and we're still in that vein of responding to the grace of God, although Paul likes to circle back, and how we are to respond. And if he tells us to have a renewing of our mind, you know, what does that renewal of mind look like? Well, here's where Paul goes. He says, for by the grace given to me, I'll go back to verse 3, please. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. He is speaking to what that new mindset looks like. And he begins by going back to grace. In particular, if you read it in the Greek, it says, actually it starts with, "for I say." That's actually the way it really starts out. "For I say," and we can't read over that too quickly. He's speaking out of the very heart of who he is. You've seen that before when someone gives a good speech, a motivational speech, or is encouraging others. They get to that point where they've given all their reasons, but then they throw themselves into the speech. You know what I'm talking about? When someone is so impassioned that they are part of the speech. You know, it doesn't matter what you're going to do. You got to make that choice. But for me, I'm going to be. And they lead from that place. And Paul is doing that. Paul is in the third verse, having built the first two verses of this appeal. He's now saying, here's where I am. Here's what I'm saying to you. I am speaking to you. And he's not just speaking to the church in Rome. He's speaking in a way that transcends time. And in essence, he is speaking to us as well. He's speaking out of the very depth of who he is. He's not speaking just to the culture of the Roman church. He's speaking to everyone who bears the name of Jesus Christ. And he's speaking out of his own living out this faith. And he's saying, I say to you. And he's doing it. Notice what he says. For by the grace given to me. Yes, he's circled back to that first part of grace. But he's being very specific. The grace given to me. I say to you, out of the grace given to me, he's not using it as an authority because God has given me grace. I have authority to speak to you. No, that's not the way he's doing that. There are times where he speaks out of his apostleship, but that's not what's happening here. He's lifting up God's grace to him, and that is his motivation to speaking to us. And what is the grace that he's received? Paul is reminding us what happened to him. He was a faithful follower of God. He was well learned in what they called the law. He knew Scripture backwards and forwards. He knew the arguments about Scriptures backwards and forwards. He was at the top of his class. He was in that class of Pharisees, often a negative class in Christian thinking, but truly someone who knew the word very well. And he was incredibly faithful to God, such that when a new sect rose up that was kind of distorting God's word as he saw it, he faithfully went out there and went to put that down, even if it meant persecuting and death of those individuals. That's the path he was on when Jesus met him on the road to Damascus. Jesus spoke to him and blinded him. Many of us who've grown up in the church have heard this story in many ways. But we need to understand that he was trying to faithfully follow God, and instead he hears this word from heaven, from the Lord Jesus Christ himself, who says, "You're on the wrong path." Now, in his mind and in his judgment, at this point, if you're on the wrong path of God, you deserve judgment. But that's not what happens to him. Instead, he receives God's grace through Jesus Christ. And he begins a new life. The scales over his eyes fall off. And he sees the world very differently. But think about all the work he had to do through all the scripture that he understood, how he had to reprocess all of it to understand what God had now done through Jesus Christ, that God truly had sent the promised one, the anointed one, the Savior. And in so doing, didn't judge Paul, but rather saved Paul from himself. Paul's whole life from that point forward is a response to the grace that God gave him. So he's been building up about this grace to the church in Rome, and he finally says, I appeal to you out of this grace. You need to change who you are. You need to present yourselves as living sacrifice, much like he had done. You need to change the way you think, much like he had done. And so now he comes back and he says, for I say to you, and I say it to you out of the very grace of God that he had received. Not because he was better, but he's being reminding them, look at, I received grace. And that's the only reason I speak to you, because I received grace. I want you to live in that grace. And he says, I say this to you, every one of you. See how it says that? Everyone among you. If you were doubting what I said earlier, that when he says, I say to you, and he wrote not just to the church in Rome, but to us ourselves, this is where you get that idea. He is writing it to everyone who has confessed Christ. I say to every one of you, and that transcends time, it transcends generations. It's for the church in Rome, it's for us, and it's for the generations to come after us. I say to every one of you, and here's the direction about that mindset. Here's the first step into that mindset. Not to think more highly than he ought to think. Not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think. Paul is going to do something here that's pretty interesting in the Greek. He takes the word think, which really at its very root is understand, and he uses it in different forms. He adds different prefixes to it, but plays with the same root word in four different ways. And actually, it's three different ways, but he does it in a way, he says it four times in three different ways. This first time, he speaks of it in terms of, hey, look, don't think in a way that puts yourself up here. And we all like to think we don't do that. You know, we're not so arrogant. We're not like that. But Paul is addressing that first original sin where we tend to think of ourselves before we think of God. Paul is addressing that first thing that really gets at the heart of each of us, that we start to think more of ourselves than we should. He dealt with this a lot in just the chapter before what we're reading now. He dealt with those Gentile Christians, those Christians who were not Jews, who suddenly were part of the faith and were looking down at the Jews that hadn't yet embraced Christ. They were feeling better about themselves, that they had been grafted into the tree of God, that they were part of the family of God, and they were thinking pretty good of themselves. And Paul squashes that and says, you're off. You're forgetting. It's not anything you've done. It's the grace of God that allows you to be here. And so what Paul is doing when he says not to think more highly of yourselves than you ought, he is reminding ourselves that what undergirds all of this in our response is the grace of God. None of us have any claim other than the grace of Jesus Christ. None of us can claim anything. This is a woeful sin that eats away at each and every church. We start to think of ourselves better than we should. We start to think of ourselves as more put together than the world out there. It's baloney. Absolute baloney. We might now be trying to live forward in Jesus Christ. We might be living in the grace and trying to become what God wants us to be. But who we are and wherever we are on that path doesn't make us any better than anyone else who hasn't started the path. Because the only thing that we can credit to ourselves is the grace of Jesus Christ. That's it. And so Paul says, when you do this reshaping of your mind, when you change the way you think, it begins by recognizing that none of us should think more of ourselves than what we are. We're sinners that have been saved through the grace of Jesus Christ. That's it. I mean, we do it all the time. We talk about people and we say, you know, well, you know, we're trying to get a feel about the person. We say, well, they go to church. And immediately we give them another credit in their column, right? We think, well, they must be a little better. And then we're surprised sometimes when someone in the church fails us and we say, but they go to church. And we think about them as a hypocrite. They're not a hypocrite. They're exactly who they always were. Sinner. The only claim we have is the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news, the grace that we've been given. And now each of us is trying to live forward, to live into who God wants us to be. But all that advancement has no claim to ourselves. So Paul starts out, look at, I want to say to you out of my own grace that I've received, I want you to be clear, I was somebody. I was a Pharisee. I was a Pharisee of Pharisees. I was in the best school, taught by the best person. That's nothing. It's nothing. I speak solely to you, he says, out of the grace of Jesus Christ. And so I warn you right away as you're thinking to make sure you don't think more highly of yourself than you ought. It's like one of the great warnings to the church. But then he makes sure that we're not just left there. He's going to give us a way to think. He wants us to think with what the ESV, the standard version here, translates as sober judgment. Sober judgment. We can grasp not to think more highly than we ought, but what am I supposed to do? Think with sober judgment. What is that? The root really is wisdom. It's a wisdom. It's a clear way of thinking. It's a way of thinking that is catching and correcting those self-interests that are in each of us. It's catching our drives and our desires that will pull us away from God. It's catching that's happening. A sober judgment, being more careful and cautious to recognize, wait a minute, what are my motivations here? We can always find a positive motivation, but what about that lurking underneath motivation that maybe isn't so positive? Paul is calling for a change of thought that no longer lives in a way of wondering how we can live up and be more than we are, of constantly creating that mask and that appearance for others, but rather to think in a way that recognizes who we really are and to think honestly about whose we are. A sober judgment, and that sober judgment is attached to what he says, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. In other words, just as he has had to look back at what God did for him, he's calling each of us in our day-to-day lives to look at what God has done for us. How much has God saved each one of us? How many of us have seen a friend or someone from the past that we used to hang with, and they've ended up in a way of life that we would have never wanted to go, and yet we recognize, just for the sake of a few decisions or things that happened, but for the grace of God, you could have been that person in that space. Or how many of us look back at our own train wreck of a life in different places, the mistakes that we've made, and realize what God has saved us from? Each of us is to look at that reality and to remember how much God has brought us forward through Jesus Christ. When we look at the failings of someone else, to look at those failings through the lens of our own failings and realize how much God has saved us and that God can do the same for that person as well. And it says that God has assigned, that God has appropriated. And the word really is parts, that God has done different parts for each one of us, each of us needing just a different kind of fix. How much of us would we like if we went to the doctor did the same part of healing for everybody who came to the doctor? You know, the kid who comes in with a cut knee, they put a Band-Aid on it. For the person coming in having a heart attack, you know, feeling like they're having a heart attack, they take and put a Band-Aid on it. For the person coming in whose leg has mangled and that you don't know if they ever could walk again, you put a Band-Aid on it. That's not the way God works. Each one of us has had a different measure of God's grace. Each one of us should look at that and recognize how much God has done for us. And this is where it gets exciting. This is where Paul's letter begins to start to take off. Remember the other week when I said these first three verses are kind of like an acorn that, you know, has got so much energy and so much power in it, and that eventually that acorn explodes and becomes a full-blown tree? This is where Paul's letter is about to burst forward. And we're going to read where this goes, because what it's going to do is it's going to go into some familiar territory for some of us. It's going to begin to talk about gifts. But we need to recall that Paul is talking about those gifts, that we get excited about. What gift do I have? What has God given to me? We need to remember that it all comes out of God's grace. And what is our response to the grace that we've been given? And Paul makes this shift into talking about gifts. He makes this shift because he uses that word assigned, which, like I said, in the Greek is all about parts, and it becomes a transition piece about moving forward out of God's grace into our response. All of us have different parts of what we've received in God's grace, and therefore we have different responsibilities as a response to God's grace. That's where Paul's moving as we read this next piece. For as in one body, we have many members. Notice the part imagery. And the members do not all have the same function. So we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, in proportion to our faith. If service, in our serving. The one who teaches, in his teaching. The one who exhorts, in his exhortation. The one who contributes, in generosity. The one who leads, with zeal. The one who does act of mercy, with cheerfulness. All of this isn't about us searching after, okay, what gift did God give me? All of this is a pushing of Paul to say, look, God has given us grace. He's reshaped and reformed each of us, and we're each being called to begin to work out what this means for us, to begin to think differently, not think more highly than we ought, but to start thinking about, okay, who am I and what am I supposed to do? And Paul begins to split that acorn out and starts to give some images of what that could look like. He lists seven different places. That doesn't mean that that's the exclusive list. It's proven because in Corinthians, he writes a different list, some of it overlapping, some of it different. Paul is using it as an image to expand on who we are to be now as followers of Jesus Christ. God has put gifts in you. And God wants you to use those gifts for His glory, for His purposes. It's all a response to the grace. You could be a wonderful preacher and get all sorts of praise for being a great preacher, but you know what? The praise isn't yours. The praise is God's. Because God gave the gifts to one to be a great preacher. God gave the gifts to another to be a great teacher. God gave the gifts to another to be an incredible leader. All of it is not so that individual could be built up, and that was certainly the danger in the church. The church struggled with that greatly early on. but rather that those gifts are all a response to God's grace and now using them for the body, for the whole, so that God's church may go forward and others may come to hear of the good news of Jesus Christ. So when we lifted up people today and prayed for them as they taught, as we said, hey, consider if the Spirit is calling you to teach at this time, recognize it's not ultimately about any of us. It's about what is God calling at this time for His church and for His children in the church. When we look over the nominations for consistory, it's not about who we think is good or we like this person as opposed to that person. It's who is God calling to be in leadership at this time. And that comes through prayer. And if you're sitting here today wondering, well, what are my gifts? Well, I don't know. You know, I'm pretty good at doing something that seems unimportant. Well, that doesn't necessarily follow. It's not about whether you think one gift is more valuable than another. Paul deals with that in his letter to the Corinthian church, like, hey, look at, they're all necessary. It's about using your gift or gifts that God has given you for God's glory, doing your best. Many of us can remember the movie Chariots of Fire. And one of the key people in that is Eric Little, one of the key runners. Eric Little is known well in the missionary world for being a missionary, but he also ran and ran in the Olympics and won. But what he said is, he says, when I run, I feel God smiling on me. He knew that his running was a gift that God had given and that he needed to run so that God would be glorified in watching the gift that he'd been given. Yes, he became a great missionary as well and died in a Japanese concentration camp, but still inspired many a person. He had more than one gift. But he did it to the glory of God. Paul is appealing out of the grace, calling us to be living sacrifices, to live into this, to change the way we see the world and think according to God's will, and to do so in a manner that puts us down, don't lift ourselves up, but rather recognizes any claim that we have is in the gospel of Jesus Christ, and that any gift we have are to be used for his purposes and for his church, all so that God may be glorified, so that we can say together with the psalmist, as we said at the start of the worship today, not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be all glory for your steadfast love and faithfulness. Amen. Let's pray. O Lord, may you be glorified. May you be glorified by our actions this morning. May you be glorified by our actions this afternoon. May you be glorified by our work this week, all our interactions, our thoughts, our words. May we strive to take another step forward in giving you glory in all these different components of our lives. Oh, we know we will fail, Lord, and when we fail, may we fall on your grace. But as we dare to take another step forward, may it always be in your power and in your strength and for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing and praise God.
In his presence daily live.
my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, humbly at His feet I fall. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender. Make me, Savior, wholly Thine. May Thy Holy Spirit fill me. May I know Thy power divine. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, Lord, I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power, let Thy blessing fall on me. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Hamilton Reformed Church, living sacrifices. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forevermore. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and